everybody. My name is Raimund Meyer. I have the pleasure and the privilege to chair this session. We are a little bit late already, because we can be a little bit longer. However, I think you make a good choice because we're talking about a very important topic here today. It's about wetland and floodplain restoration. Maybe just administratively, when we look at the program, actually the same rules are indicated for two sessions. The info session is not in the other room, so everybody who is here, you're aware we're dealing with wetlands and floodplains here right now. So we're stepping out from the river. And I'm sure you're not only here for the good view, which is a bit quite funny, but for the topic itself. Since the program is quite packed, I would suggest that we immediately start, also with the first presentation. We've got four speakers, and the first one, the first session will be from Louise Everday. And Louise will talk about, from a first implementation, WWF report for integrated river and floodplain restoration. Maybe to add also, Louise is the head of the Tanikabelken program, the DCP, DCP freshwater program, and is dealing there with restoration issues, with topics like water framework directive, to avoid future deterioration, also water status, and the excursion topics, for instance, as well. Louise, you're invited to write your presentation.
Thank you. Good morning. Welcome, everybody. I would like to just give a short warm-up presentation and highlight some key aspects what we as WWF think in this region about restoration, how this should look like on a general level. What we have now at the moment, and what when I'm saying we, means the countries in our region. We have the river basin management plans, the Danube basin level river basin management plan, different kind of other plans which contain elements of restorations, like master plans which contains folders, creating folders or flood reservoirs. We have also a lot of very nice projects in the countries, which aim was or is to restore rivers, floodplains, wetlands. So there are different type of experiences. The approach now, our feeling is, if we consider on national level the restoration, that for example what are in the river basin management plans, these are really ambitious, sometimes less, but let's say quite ambitious objectives there, and long list of what we should do in the countries to reach the good ecological, chemical, etc. status. And it's so hard to start because it's so low, it's like a mission impossible, and we don't know where to start, for example, the restorations. In a lot of cases, what we see that only the technical aspects are considered. Okay, from hydromorphological point of view, is it feasible or not? But there is lack of ingredients, let's say, in terms of stakeholder will. In the plans, the approach, the interest of the stakeholder is not represented or not enough. Mostly, in the countries, there are small restorations. When I'm saying small, let's say 50 hectares, 100 hectares, which is still very hard, I know, to have 100 hectare restoration. But still, comparing to the potential floodplain, what we could restore, it's still not enough. And what we see that now the restorations are mainly focusing on the active floodplains, so between the dikes and not outside the dikes. Or if it is considered beyond the flood protection dikes, that these are mainly folders, flood retention reservoirs, and emergency reservoirs. what we think as WWF, what we would like to highlight, what should be the required approach, or let's say next steps. We should also think how large-scale restoration can be implemented when we are talking about 1,000, several thousands of hectares, one site to be restored. Also, we should consider how we can multiply the restoration project, not only have some pilot sites, but a chain, let's say, of latte restorations. We need a strategic approach, not only be opportunistic, okay, if there is some funding, we go for a restoration. We need to plan it properly. And also the integrated approach is important. Floodplain restoration is not the business of water management. A lot of other sectors have to be on board and implement it together, starting from agriculture, forestry, fishery, of course, environment, nature protection as well. So this is really something integrated, not only about water management. And what we think that we should also consider the areas outside the flood protection types, the former floodplains, before the regulation. How we see the process, how we could tackle it on national level, how to start. Of course, first we need an inventory of the existing floodplains and also define what type of floodplains we have along the rivers. Based on different type of criteria, we should focus, we should prioritize, okay, which are those first one, two, three sites that we should start with. Meantime, parallel, what is very important, we should set the financial background, and this is not only about ensuring money for a restoration, but this is also about changing, modifying, for example, subsidy systems or any type of financial support systems, for example, agriculture subsidy. When we are talking about floodplain restoration, where there are a lot of agricultural lands, we have to change the land use. Without proper agriculture financial support or system, this cannot be realized. Also, we need the proper legal background for this. Of course, we need the knowledge and enough capacity, institutional background, and the proper stakeholder involvement. We talked a lot about stakeholder involvement, also in this conference, but in general. But a proper stakeholder involvement is a bit different. So there is still space to improve that. And if we have everything, then of course we can start to implement the restorations. And then we need to monitor if really the desired outcome is there, what we wanted to achieve. And also, I think it's very important to share the lessons learned and use them. So this is, let's say, the process, how we see. And I will pick up some aspects that I would like to detail a bit. For example, when we are talking about how we prioritize the sites, this could be technical criteria, okay, what is the hydromorphological condition, the protection status, the biodiversity status there, the land use coverage. That area is only agricultural land, or only a small portion is agricultural land, and the biggest one is really good to be restored because it's quite close to nature. But what is very important parallel, apart from the technical criteria, are the social economic aspects. What is the situation, the land ownership, land user situation? In a lot of cases, even if we have a technical feasibility study, that the restoration is blocked because of the land ownership or land user will situation, let's say. We also need to consider when we prioritize which site should be the first. If we could combine this to a socio-economic benefit, if there is a site, let's say there are several sites which would be good from technical point of view to be restored. Okay, but if one of them is good for reducing the flood peak, then let's prioritize that one. Let's go for that first. Because then we can combine reducing the flood peak with floodplain restoration. So we can combine the benefits, let's say. Some words about the financial background. There are different kind of opportunities to finance restorations, even if we always say that, oh, there is not enough money. I will show you a table. What is the problem that the financial resources available for restorations are really splitted up, I will tell you how. And just sometimes really for the applicants it's hard to go for funding because there are strict stipulations, requirements. It's not a full list what you see, but what I try to show you that on the left side, there are different kind of parts of a restoration. When you prepare a pre-feasibility or feasibility study, or when you want to do field work, or monitoring, or train the farmers. And for different kind of parts of a restoration, there are different kind of funding sources available. So, you can see that from the Danube Transnational Program under the Danube Strategy, or LIFE, or Horizon 2020, or the European Structural Investment Funds, or the CAP, Pillar 2, the Common Agricultural Policy, Pillar 2, the Rural Development Programs, Interreg. So there are available funds, but they are really splitted up, let's say. So what we think would be also important, if we go for a large-scale restoration, then all the elements of the restoration should be financed from $1. Not saying that, okay, the pre-feasibility study from this donor, the other part of the restoration from another donor, and trying to pick up the puzzles. But it's better if we could handle this in one package in terms of financing restoration. Of course, what is important that in the decision-making process, the local interest should be taken into account. Co-finance is always a program, so there should be some more institutional background for this, because sometimes everything is there, also the local will, the feasibility, just simply the co-finance is missing and institutions cannot go for example, new funds. And of course, what is crucial, what I mentioned, the proper incentives for land users to change land use. If I want to restore a site from crop growing toward extensive land use, we need some financial incentives for the farmers. Additional to the national level background, additionally, for example, the payment for ecosystem services could be also something which is a financial incentive. The local business, let's say. So, if during the restoration there is, let's say, more water in an area which is good for a rice farm owner, then he could be interested in the restoration and he will undertake the maintenance cost after the restoration. Of course, it's always the case of the negotiation on the concrete side. Or using the reed as biomass. Some key thoughts concerning the stakeholder involvement, what we think are the key aspects, let's say, involve stakeholders in time, on the necessary level, which means that there are stakeholders who should be only informed, some of them should be involved and consulted, or even more, there is always a smaller group who should be involved in the decision making. if we do the stakeholder involvement, it helps us to prioritize the sites, because if there is a site with the local will, then maybe we should go for that site. Of course, we can save money because we can design realistic measures and not useless measures. And what is important, that after the restoration, it should be viable. So if there is the local will there, who could maintain the results, then this is the win-win situation. And also, what is the win-win situation if we can combine the ecological, social, and economic aspects in restoration. And I know that I run out of the time, so these are just some restoration sites, what we are doing together with, of course, partners. And in our restoration works, we have also field model projects. We are doing policy advocacy work and communication. What I would like to highlight, apart from the field works, that we also try to help on national level the countries to tackle larger scale restorations, to find out what are the legal and financial obstacles, if there are, and they are to be tackled. Also, we are contributing or trying to influence different kind of concepts and plans. Also, some colleagues are working on influencing EU funds. So, a concrete type of fund should support more green infrastructure, for example. Of course, communication, and what I would like to highlight, restoration costs a lot of money. So from cost-benefit point of view, to avoid future deterioration is quite beneficial. So if we go for a new infrastructure project, it should be considered what we destroy, because then it should be restored. So again, the scheme, and my colleagues will talk about some part of this scheme. Ulrike from Coke company, she will highlight a very interesting aspect, I would say, about integration and how different sectors cooperate in restoration. And Vicky and Christian will show you concrete examples on the ground. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, good morning. Yes, I've been asked to give a little business perspective on the topic. And I think I've been enjoying this conference this morning already, twice the importance of stakeholder engagement, including business. And so I think what I'd like to achieve maybe with my few slides is to give you an impression and maybe an example of how our company looks at our involvement in river basin management. I don't want to suggest that there are lots of businesses queuing up to engage, to work on this. Simply, and I think that's one of my starting theses, the distance between what integrated river basin management is and the concept and the work required for that, and the longevity of any projects and complexity of getting anything done, and the way business thinks is very wide. And I think partly that's the bridging by increasing understanding how each side is functioning. Might be the first step to get better stakeholder engagement. So my contribution to this workshop should be to maybe help bridging the gap by giving a bit of understanding of how we are looking at this as an example, but certainly not as talking for business in general. I think that needs to be mapped out on a local basis or river basin basis in each case, and see who could be a potential partner and why, and how could that work together. So very briefly, maybe starting with how water fits into our overall 2020 sustainability framework. And I think that's for many businesses the starting point. What is the strategy? What is the point of view on sustainability, and how does water as a resource fit into that? For us at Coca-Cola globally, water is one of the key strategic priorities. We have three pillars on sustainability. One is around me, which is personal well-being. One is around we in the middle, which is about community engagement and foundations for communities. That's, of course, a lot to do with you know, human and workplace rights, but also charitable contribution, disaster relief, etc. And world is around the environment. And there, water is very firmly on the agenda. And if I'd like to say how our, you know, our boardroom looks at this framework, they say, well, we have to be holistic, so we have many different aspects of personal well-being, community well-being, and environment in there. But if I need to name our three big priorities, it is around well-being, it is around women empowerment, and it is around water. So out of the four areas of environmental priorities, water is really the top priority. And why is that? Well, simply because there is a growing realization, and not only in our business certainly, that water is the biggest part of our supply chain and it is under growing stress. So both in terms of the importance of water resources to our direct operations, meaning putting water into bottles together and other stuff and selling it as a wide range of products, it also transpires increasingly that water risks are coming through our supply chain, particularly where we buy agricultural ingredients, and that includes sweeteners, of course, but it also includes fruit, coffee, tea, etc. So all agricultural ingredients that are in our supply chain, we see it coming through different routes, and I don't need to tell this audience what these are in terms of droughts, quality issues, pricing, and other stress factors that we see coming through. And we certainly have tools, and as business ourselves, but also as industry, have tools in place to have that on the radar, and increasingly tracking that. And I think that's maybe another element to tap into those tools if you want to engage with business, to understand what we are seeing and what we see coming through our supply chain in terms of importance of water to our sustainability of our businesses. And it is not only a developing world issue. I think that this is becoming increasingly clear. Again, it's important as many companies are having their boardrooms in the developed world, but see it coming through more and more clearly, and making that point is important, and we realize that. What is our water stewardship strategy globally? Well, first of all, of course, is to ensure sustainable water use in our operations. It's first of all to secure how we're using water in our own four walls, and that includes understanding the resources that we're using in our bottling plants, ensuring the protection of those resources, increasing water efficiency, and ensuring adequate wastewater treatment. It's very basic. How do you make your operations more water sustainable? The second piece is Coke specific, which is we've made a commitment to give back to nature and community the water we actually use. So what goes into the bottles, into the cans, into the product, that amount of water we want to give back as a concept. And that means we are investing as part of that commitment into projects and programs to ensure access to water for communities that don't have it, to improve storage of water resources and improve quality, to help others along the supply chain, including farmers and farming communities, to increase their efficiency, to reduce their water use where it is quite high, and to contribute through education and awareness raising to get overall better understanding of water use. And I'm going to come back to that a bit more, because that's where our cooperation on with WWF in particular, but also with others on river basin management comes in. And finally, and again, that is starting to look for many businesses along the value chain, is that we are looking increasingly at sustainable water use in our supply chain. And I referenced agricultural ingredients and that the contribution of our agricultural ingredients overall to sustainability of the business, but also to water use, has come very much to the fore and is now a core part of our strategy. So the sustainable sourcing commitment that we've taken is a direct response to our growing understanding of water issues impacting our value chain. And across all of that, advocacy, partnerships, working with others, and raising the stakes on a common understanding of water resources and the importance of fresh water to humanity and business, of course, is a core part of that strategy. We can't do that alone. We're just a business, frankly, and we have many qualities and areas of expertise, but certainly that is a piece too big for us. So we need to work in partnerships, and partnerships and collaboration with other organizations are an absolute key part to how we want to achieve and can achieve that strategy. You see a number of public organizations, but also NGOs in there, and they are for us absolutely critical because they bring the expertise, they bring the local networks, and they bring the community engagement, which we can partly contribute to, but certainly not all of that. And an example I want to point out and pull out is our global partnership with WWF, which is really a global partnership since 2007. We have renewed that partnership in 2013 for another 7 years, and it focuses on three main areas of work. One is freshwater conservation, again, because it is so important to our business, and that means we are working together in 11 river basins across the world. That includes the Mekong, includes the Amazon, includes the Zambezi, and includes many others, Mesoamerican Reef, etc. There's more information I can give you if you want to know more of that. But just to say, we really have put tangible actions and programs and investments on the card to say, in those core river basins, we want to make a difference in the next 7 years, and we put investment and time and projects behind that. Secondly, it's working together on global value chains. It is about WWF helping us to improve the sustainable sourcing of our core commodities and to help us understand where water use plays into that and how we, through our procurement function, through setting the right requirements down the value chain, can actually influence farming behavior, if you like, positively, and how we can contribute to better water management on the farms and in the fields. And thirdly, it's about valuing nature, which is what I've recognized in the keynote speech in the beginning, is about looking at ecosystem services and what their benefit is for businesses and how we can value nature and ecosystem services and bring them into our business understanding of money and business benefits and try to translate that value into a more business-friendly language. That's, I think it seems to be a way around, but it is critical because otherwise there is no understanding and translation of what ecosystem services are and what the benefits of that is to the business. Just an example of how all of that trickles down to concrete action on the ground, and here particularly in Europe, because that's what I'm talking about. So our water program of giving back to communities and nature means there are concrete projects and investments behind that across Europe with different partners. What is highlighted here in green are local programs with the local WWF teams in the UK, in Spain, and in France. And one of the biggest highlights is the Danube partnership that we have here, which goes across 6 countries for 7 years and has a substantial investment behind it as well. And essentially it's a $4.5 million investment over those 7 years to put in particularly river restoration and wetland restoration projects across those regions. It's about this point of integration and trying to have one program that hits on different angles across a certain period of time to give planning security and actually increase impact. I'm not going to go into details, but there is information available of what is going to happen in each of those countries according to the plan, but again, it reflects the map that Louise has shown earlier. So to bring the interests and planning of both organizations together is a key element in success of a partnership. And I go very briefly over that, because of course there are interests that each organization has. So WWF is very clearly a conservation organization, and they would like to have a certain planning, pipeline, and security and integration of their long-term conservation goals, which they would like to achieve, I would say, with going into partnerships like the one with us. On our side, we have a commitment made to 2020. We want to give back to community and nature the water we use, and we need to have a certain program to increase the availability of water resources that corresponds to that commitment. So for us, of course, it is the ability to build a clear long-term roadmap towards achieving that commitment that is driving us to work into a partnership like this. But from then on, there are a number of shared interests and benefits that working together brings. Well, first of all, there is smart investment. Because for us, we can invest in a long-term, reliable partnership and program that we know is going to be delivered with a good partner. But equally, it allows them further scaling and leverage of that investment with other funds. So Life Plus, for example, the European fund, works only if there is co-funding from other resources. So unless there is that co-funding, you don't get that scale. But if there is, well, you can also get that scale, and you know that your investment as a private entity brings a much bigger impact further down the line through the leverage. There is increased efficiency, of course, and effectiveness, because the skills and the tools that can be exchanged between very different organizations are very helpful. Capability building on our side, but I would also say to some extent in certain elements on the other side, is critical, and an employee or engagement on both sides also has a benefit in itself. Better governance. Long-term programs, we find, ensure a better governance of the projects, because you're not in and out for 1 year, you actually set up a governance structure that goes you through the whole length of time, and that means you have better planning, you have better joint monitoring, and you have exchange of view going forward. And finally, it gives you a certain platform to increase your outreach to different audiences, to more diverse audiences. And I think that is, to some extent, one of my points maybe that I would really like to make to this audience and around Evero Basin Management, and why business has maybe sometimes difficulty to really engage, is communication around it, and trying to explain what is happening, all the wealth of activities that are happening around Evero Basin Management, to including consumers, but also making it more palatable, let's say, to a wider audience and communication. So that is why I'd like to maybe briefly show you a film, which is part of how, by working together, we've been trying to not only do the right thing, but also talk about it, and talk about it in a way that could maybe be more approachable and accessible for other people. And I hope
Danube River Basin is the most international one in the world. 80 million people live along the Danube or its tributaries, from the Black Forest in Germany to the Black Sea. The fate of the mighty Danube depends on its tributaries, small arms, and bars. The Semenjeca swamp in the Stuttgart area of the Gornja Podunavlje Special Nature Reserve lies at the border of Serbia, Croatia, and Hungary. Swamps like this are home to hundreds of plant and animal species. Fortunately, swamps need our help. The Danube has lost 80% of its former floodplains, and with them its biodiversity. Essential ecosystem services that people think that they receive from nature for free can no longer be provided by the Danube, from flood protection to water purification. An ongoing partnership between Coca-Cola and the World Wide Fund for Nature has the goal to improve the Danube River Basin. It should cost 11 hectares of precious floodplain.
U saradnji sa WWF-om, Svetskim fondom za zaštitu prirode i Vojvodine šume. Projekat koji je zamišljen nešto novo, nikad rađeno do sada na ovim terenima.
Restoration of Stuttgart aims to promote the re-establishment of natural habitats like wet meadows and shallow ponds, improve the conservation of species, and enhance the possibilities for local sustainable ecotourism, particularly bird watching.
Projekti poput ovog prokoga realizuje Svetski fond za zaštitu prirode, u velikoj meri doprinose razvoju sela i uopšte razvoju ekonomskog turizma u Bačkom Monoštoru, koji je aktualan već nekih deseta godina. I jako dobro pokazatelj svega toga je činjenica da veoma mali broj ljudi, mladih ljudi, napušta Bački Monoštor, već naprotiv se i doseljavaju u Bački Monoštor da žive oko jedne ide dobro šanse.
Našim aktivnostima smo vratili vodu u Barisku Nemoću. Voda je vratila život, vratili se biljke i vratili se životinje. Na nama je da je zajedno sa lokalnom zajednicom očuvamo ovu vodu za buduće generacije.
Okay? I think I'll leave it at that. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Let me introduce a field example, which was implemented in Hungary in the lower part of the Danube section. This field example is important for us because, as Doris tried to describe shortly but very precisely what are the circumstances and what are the points for selection of a project which we implement, which is very, really important to select a project which will be successful in the end because we spend a lot of time and effort in it and of course it costs a lot. This project was selected on the basis of several things. First, we made a pre-feasibility study, which was also important. And as you can see on this photo, this is an island and a side branch on the Danube, which was in really such a condition, which was, let's say, the last minute to save. You can see considerable sedimentation, and in some parts of this side branch, the island is nearly sticked to the riverbank, which means that in a few decades it would be disappeared. And as we know that the regulated Danube is not able to build new islands, that's why, in spite of the fact that the sedimentation and the natural dynamism of the change of the riverside arms and side branches are natural, but in this specific case, because the river is not able to develop new islands and side branches, it is very important somehow to preserve the existing ones. The preparations took some years, 3 or 4 years, and it is very important that the WWF was contacted several times by a mayor of this nearby city who was keen on this area, and he was really an initiator of this project. And based on his idea, WWF examined what the situation is, and then we realized that this is a really good idea and a really good point, not only because of the mayor's idea, because his point was specifically the recreation. But we designed and realized that there are much more opportunity in this project. Because an extra added value was that conservation economics could meet in the ecosystem services. I will tell a little bit later about it. And the partnership that we needed, actually the project needed, involved several partners, including state bodies, NGOs, local communities, and corporations. The preparation, I mean the concrete preparation of the project, the development and the convincing of all these partners to participate and take them on board took approximately 2 years, including proposal writing and the decision-making procedure. Finally, in the year 2007, we submitted a proposal to Life Nature, which we got supported. Because we have a priority habitat, we received 75% of support on most of the costs, but we had an ineligible cost because of an infrastructure element which was necessary, and without that the whole project would not be able to finalize. Therefore, all in all, the support intensity is 60%. The NGO was involved WWF Hungary, which was the lead partner of this project, and we involved three state bodies, actually two real state bodies, National Park and Water Management Directorate. And the third one is looking like a corporation, but it is a state-owned, which is a water service providing company. And we also had the municipality of the nearby town called Mohács. The real corporation in this project is Coca-Cola Hungary, which was involved, and without their great support, this project would not be able to be finalized. Just a few words about the project. As you have seen on the aerial photo, we have an island and a side branch. The size, just to give an impression, is 47 hectares, which is a strictly protected area, which was owned before privately, and thanks to the project we could purchase the island, and now it is owned by the state and managed by the local national park. The vegetation on the island is forest now, so it's not a young island, but the vegetation is softwood forest with, of course, opportunity, I have to say, of course, with a certain invasive pressure. The side branch is approximately 3 kilometers long. It's a middle-sized side branch, let's say, and because of certain human activities, there was advanced sedimentation, and the water quality was quite bad, and it was quite different habitat than it should be. First, I tried to group the problems. Of course, there are several impacts and implications to each other, but mainly we have two big problems. One is the first one is that no longitudinal connectivity was in the side branch. It was mainly because the Rockfield Dam was built in 1982, which means that within three decades, a height change, a really considerable change was happened in the side branch. And the sedimentation is the second reason within this group, but the whole origin is the Rockfield Dam, which we needed three technical steps in restoration to fix, let's say, fix it. One was dredging the side dam and then relocating the water pipes in the dam, because in the Rockfield Dam, because there was not only a pure Rockfield Dam, there was a water pipe in it, which gives a special importance of the project, because there are the wells along the Danube bank, which providing drinking water for people in the region, and that's why these two large-sized water pipes were needed. And after all these were done, we had to open the Rockfield Dam to let the river flow. Just to show the same photo again, now you can see which problem was there. The southern point of the side branch is signed in the bottom of the picture where I signed sedimentation, but of course the opposite end has the same problem or had the same problem. The Rockfield Dam is at about one third of the island on the northern part, and the invasives were affecting most of the forests of the island with a specific spot where there was a bad quality hybrid poplar plantation which was highly infected with invasives. Also, in the water wells are on the left side of the left bank of the river, marked with blue. This is just a photo of the Rockfield Dam, the root of all problems. And the second part of the problem was focusing on the island and the vegetation, the forests on the island, and the invasives. We targeted to control the invasives because, of course, it's impossible to decrease their ratio under zero. Just briefly about the solutions. The basic was the dredging in the side branch, which was an ecological purpose dredging. It was really a large scale construction or reconstruction work, but it was unavoidable in case of this project. And I think we did really little harm, because this side branch was in such a bad condition that this dredging was really a kind of necessary and really good thing. The requirement was that we know that this type of sidearm has a natural process of sedimentation, but the requirement for the designer was to try to prolong this procedure as far as it is possible. At the end, we ended up after the dredging with an artificial shaped side branch. But after the first flood, we had some measurements, and it turned out that the river tried to re-naturalize this, let's say, channel, which is still a point of observation, and we have to continue it for a long time, because we think that we know how rivers work, but after time to time, it turns out that we have some surprises. But this is definitely a good opportunity that the water can flow through the side branch the whole year round. I have some photos about these large-scale works, which is quite interesting. I was always judged by friends that you are nature conservationists and you are doing such a ugly and such a huge construction and reconstruction works. But after some other discussion, they are always convinced that these things are needed. And their imagination, when they think and believe that nature conservationists are looking always the beautiful things and pet cute beavers, that is not true.
we released the sediment in the main branch of the Danube because there is lack of sediment. And this is the photo which was made during the dredging works that gives an impression. On the left side you can see the island and the really narrow kind of creek, which is the remnant of the old times. And on the right side you can see the real flowing side branch. The Rockfield Dam opening, as I mentioned, was really necessary to let the water flow, and before the opening we had to relocate the water pipes. This Rockfield Dam originally was built because of navigation purposes, and then it was hastened because of the water pipes, which resulted that approximately a few days of a year was when the water could flow in the side branch, but of course with this huge, let's say, threshold. Or threshold, yes. But it was completely, it resulted completely change the circumstances in this river arm. In the project we used a very new, let's say new technology in nature conservation. In road construction it's not new. This is the horizontal driven drilling technology. I will show a basic photo about how it works. And the dam was open, but the height was decreased by 2 meters all along. This is how it works. It's important because it's easy to use this way. It requires the less time on the surface. On the two ends, of course, we had to open the soil surface, and these huge works were finished within 1.5 months. And after, finally, in the end of all construction and reconstruction works, we could make an opening in the Rockfield Dam, which took a few weeks only. First, we had several problems, which we had responses and solutions how to make a better quality of habitat for wildlife, and parallel, to provide better circumstances for people through ecosystem services. The Rockfield Dam was open. We removed several thousand cubic meters of stones, but the most important thing is that the water flow, and as an impact on the water wells on the riverbank, it is important to have a natural filtration, both physically and chemically. In the side branch, we had shallow and standing water, stagnant water with low oxygen content, and of course different habitat attracted different species. And after opening the side branch and the water flow is possible, we had some, of course it takes more time to have real changes, but after just opening we had some that kind of fish species in the side branch which require flowing water. Of course, that would be a loss if the island and the side branch would disappear, but now it's safe from this point of view. And on the island, we had previously commercial forestry. Of course, private owners wanted to collect wood and take or have income from them, but now the forestry plan contains only nature conservation purpose forest management. And the invasive tree species are under control. We focused on the tree, on the seed shedding individuals, but after the project is closed, this work will not close. It will be continued by the national park, and they will also always keep under a certain limit the number of these species and individuals. The results for nature to having better quality of habitats and the disappearing and very rare side branches are enriched with one more. And on the island we have semi-natural alluvial forest because we restored on the place of the hybrid poplar plantation, we reintroduced semi-natural softwood forest. And we also already see returning some species like beaver, black kite, the otters, and different wader bird species. For people, which is very important, in case of this project we were lucky with people because our interest was mainly in harmony with their interest. Of course they were interested in the recreation part, and the WWF point was the more complex view, but in this lucky situation we had no fight with them. Maybe with the owners of the forest on the island because they were not very happy to sell it, which needed some years of discussion and convincing, but finally we could get it. And for local people, it is a place not only for angling and fishing and for different water sports, but the drinking water is clearer and safer, as I described. And it's also important that there is a various nature trail which can show them only from boats and canoes on the edge of the island how the project is and how ski ranches work and why they are important for people's lives. And of course this is only a small contribution, but in flood peak mitigation it's important. It is measured, it's very sophisticated, that 1 centimeter is decreased in the main branch during floods thanks to the flowing water part in the side branch, which is interesting to measure 1 centimeter in case of a waving river, but 1 centimeter is something. And if we have 20 side branches or 50, it is really important. And that's why I'm happy and I want to encourage all people to make some similar projects because they have added their results are added. These are the water wells and some photos of recreation. The kids are very talented. In Mohács they have a rowing club, this is the local beach, nature study trail, which is this is a special construction which can follow the water rise and fall, and of course flood mitigation is important. This photo was not taken here. Just a drawing about the multiple benefits and some before and after photos from the electric pole. You can see that we are really on the same place. This was before the project. It was just a small, let's say, creek, and this was after the project. The same pole is circled. From the air, bird's eye view, before, after, and thank you. This is hopefully the future. We want to have them nesting on the island. Now we provide just feeding habitats for them. And I have to announce that in the afternoon, in the session number 6, there's going to be a movie of this project presented, which is 14 minutes long, and you are welcome to see. And I also have some copies of the DVD with me, if someone interested, I can, and I'm happy to give one. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the presentation. A slight change, it will not be only from one project, but 3 projects, because when I was asked to give a presentation about the lessons, I said, okay, we learned something during this project, especially the stakeholder involvement. And I said, okay, why not to share this with you today? And the second reason was that it's difficult when you talk about flood restoration, or restoration in general, to choose just one topic and then to go a little bit farther with the lesson learned. So I choose stakeholder involvement because this is, in my opinion, our opinion, a crucial element for the success of wetland restoration. And we have to face it, I think everybody agrees that wetland restoration or flood restoration is not a technical issue, it's just a society issue. So we have to address properly, and here I think stakeholder involvement is really important. And also because in theory, but also in practice, for example, it is the Society for Ecological Restoration guidelines, yes, principles, saying that flood restoration or restoration should be engaging. I'm skipping the other two because it should be effective. This is a technical aspect, and most of the time it's easy to deal with this because we have the knowledge and the science. Should be efficient. This is also really, really measurable. We have the tools nowadays. But to be engaging is really something challenging. And like it is expressed here, if we think at the evolution of the ecosystem degradation curve, we have to think of 3 possibilities having restoration based on ecology only. And usually this is something that most of the conservationists in the last decades they did. They consider only the ecological aspects, not including the economic or socio-economic benefits. And when they start the projects somewhere just after, immediately after the proposal, the support of the stakeholders is decreasing, so most of these projects they fail because of this lack. But then if we include only the society and we just consider broader benefits, also people they will get very enthusiastic in the beginning, but during the process they will notice immediately that it's not the case and they have no stake or economic financial benefits, and they will not support on long term the restoration, so that there is the risk that the restoration projects they fail in time. But when we include both ecological society and economic aspects, there is a higher degree of success on long term. So this is more or less to convince you that it's important to address the stakeholder involvement really, really seriously. And I'm trying also to give some examples from the Europe, but not before to mention that flood restoration, I think it's a process of change for people, and we have to address this as it is. It's a process of change that affects many stakeholders with different interests and, most important, with different values. That makes a little bit more complicated the schemes for the restorations and also the to align all this value. And then we have the policy, yes, this is really supportive. We have the financial means, donors, and the EU budget, and so on. But most of the project restoration happened at the local level, and the decision is taken at the local level. And there is a little bit of gap between the policy aspects and what happens in the field, in our opinion. And that's mostly because usually, as people, we change our attitude towards things because of various reasons, internal or external. I mean, at the beginning of the project, it might be the case that most of the people, they support the idea, they like it, they see some economic benefits, but during the implementation, because the implementation takes time, 2, 3, 4, 5 years, sometimes people, they change because of various reasons. A rich guy came, put the money, buy the land, and build something over there. Could be the case. So we have to take into account this attitude that is changing over time, especially on large restoration projects that happen on a larger time scale. Yeah? Another thing which is important from the experience over the Europe is that the flood restoration is site-specific, both from technical point of view, but also from the stakeholder involvement. I mean, there is no one solution to involve stakeholders in two different sites. I mean, some people they can agree or they can take it easily, they can see easily the benefits, but in other sites it could be complicated. So we have to refer to this context when we talk about the floodplain restoration initiatives. And most of the successes in Europe depends on changing the traditional attitude from the flood defense practice, which is widely financed. Another aspect which I think is important, it was also mentioned in the previous presentation during this morning, but also yesterday, is that we start to think at wetland restoration, at flood restoration, only after a major distress, which is practically basically an emotional experience. And only then people, they go out of their comfort zones and start thinking how to deal with the problem in a different way, because they understand sometimes the old ways not work. And that makes, in most of the cases in Europe, a voluntary approach towards the flood restoration. Although we have good policy in Europe, that is not binding. It's not a legal requirement for the member states, so it's just mostly voluntary. And the same approach from Europe was also done by WWF together with ICPDR, another organization, to see what are the restoration areas, potential restoration areas along the Danube. And this is a map showing the flooded areas after the floods in 2006, which are the major floods in most of the countries. We came up with these potential restoration areas that are planned in different policy or regulatory papers, but also potential, I mean, that we know this is possible. And only along the North Danube Green Corridor there is a potential for the restoration of almost 500,000 hectares. But that doesn't mean that, you know, it's very easy to implement this. The same emotional distress, let's say, happened also in Romania in 2006, and after that the Minister of Environment did a study for the economic and ecological redevelopment of the Danube floodplains, and the study is saying that we can restore for nature mostly this amount of hectares, and then they are proposed some what's called storage, some holders for storage on this area. Also, there are arable lands that is very difficult to, from their opinion, from the economic feasibility of the floodplain at that time, 2007-8. So these are questionable if we can have mixed solutions or they should stay like that. So considering these simple things that, you know, people attitudes change over time and they have to decide, and most of the cases they have the last word in the restoration, there is one question we have to ask, in my opinion, how we can build capacity for continued support of stakeholders' engagement in floodplain restoration initiatives. And as I said at the beginning, it was very difficult for me to stop at one project, because we have many in Romania, these are just three of them, and they are good cases because it's a different land ownership, different solutions and so on. I'll just briefly go through them. I'll start with the one that was finalized in 2012, and that was to restore the hydrology of an existing floodplain in Romania, something like 1,500 hectares. And the financing was from the LIFE, new instrument, so it was dedicated for nature, but the benefits are also for locals and others, and I'll explain this a little further. A project that is ongoing, the works they started in August this year, is something like 924 hectares. It's in the Danube Delta, and the local community, they really wanted to flood their arable lands because they didn't consider to bring too much benefits, and they saw much benefits to weather restoration. And I'll go through this later on. And a project that is financed by the Coca-Cola, it's the reconnection of the connectivity of the river with the floodplain, something like 1,600 hectares. It's a partially a marsh and a fish farm. So this is the project we finalized in 2013. It's the old river confluence with the Danube River, south Romania. And just to demonstrate that we're not talking from Chile, this is the first, let's say, initial small flooding after we built a channel, and then we blocked the former drainage system that was done in the past, and then this is after the first year of flooding. Basically, the idea was to keep the water, extend the period of the water staying in the area. A lot of benefits for nature, but not only. The second project, it's Gâlamare. This is still ongoing, but the idea is to reconnect through here all this area and have it, you know, exit here to some inlet and outlet channels. Also pretty challenging, but here it's, you know, this part actually to be reconnected. It's a former abandoned fish farm that has no benefits for the owner, but they see only opportunities through wetland restoration. So why it's important to include people in this in the restoration projects. First, it's a legal requirement, but it's also an ethical aspect. There are many places along the rivers in Europe where through dredging and embankments, at that time it was, you know, something like a social inequity that we have to restore. So it's also an ethical requirement in our opinion. For this we need a good collaboration process. And first, and I think that was also mentioned in different presentations, is to listen to the local people because they have the traditional knowledge, and still having this traditional knowledge, they can easily accept the restoration because they know that there is a value over there, and they know also how to manage this area after the restoration, which is also important aspects on long-term sustainability of the restoration project. It's important to evaluate and re-evaluate if the works are accepted, everybody is on the same page and every interest is respected in that restoration plan. And of course, everybody accepts it if you go through all these aspects of review. So, on the right side, it's pretty much the theory behind the attitude change of the people, and here is something that we just did on short only to understand. So there are some stages you have to consider when you work with the people. The fact that they have to contemplate and pre-contemplate what you propose to them, and that usually takes a period of tolerance, 3 or 6 months. You have to go there more often and see exactly what is their perception about what you want to do there, and then you have to prepare them and include them in the preparation of the projects, and only after that to take actions. For example, in the project in Danube Delta, it took us something like 4 years before to start the project to agree on different aspects, technical, administrative, but also local aspects. On Gârla Mare, for example, we are still negotiating some aspects with the owners. They are technical, but generally we solve the problem. And exemplify for Balta Gerani, we get along. But basically, we start considering what are the values and risks for these stakeholders, and then we try to promote common benefits. Why it's important to promote common benefits? Because a local community is not everyone has a land or a business that is related to the restoration site. So you want to have them on board. So we have to promote something more, not just, you know, what happens with the land compensation, whatever. And then it's important, like I showed in the first diagram, to provide some economic alternatives or opportunities, at least to put something on the side so that they can stay with you until the end of the project, and after that doing monitoring, and after that in the management of that area. So it's not really easy. When you talk about the values of risk, I'm referring to those values on without people or businesses cannot exist. If you affect a business that, you know, for example, it's somebody that is having a factory and you want to remove that factory, you have to think if he or that business can exist in other places. And you have to include this in the proposal. You have to include this in the restoration scheme. So it's really, really challenging. Usually landowners ask if they have something to lose on that. We have to explain what it is, how we compensate that, what we offer in exchange, land exchange or compensation, or buy the land, and different alternatives. And that's pretty much just a guide on questions on this. For example, in Balta Gerai, this is the area that was restored through inlet channels, collecting all the springs from the terrace and blocking the main drainage channels that were built transversely and longitudinally. So in this case, for example, there are something like 900 landowners on this area. So having like here small parcels, but like that on stripes. Yeah. So we have to deal with all 900 stakeholders. And for them it was not something with great value, they still remembered how the area was before the, to be embanked. It was somehow an advantage in this context, but we still have to negotiate them and go and have public debates and ask for their signature in order to do the feasibility study first and then to receive the permits of work. So it's really, really interesting. And, oh, sorry. And on this land, surprisingly, they receive compensation, although it's a flooded area, because they have lands there. There is a law in Romania that's stipulating that if your land is flooded, you receive some compensation. So mechanism to compensate flooded area exists. But you said, we're not affecting this interest. Actually, we just put something saying that it's flooded area, it's your land, if you have a property paper, you still can receive compensation. This might be 50 euro or 60 euro per year, but anyway, for local people, it's something that they feel they can have. On Gârla Mare, the reconnection of the former marsh here, which was transformed in fish farm, sorry, through a channel, through opening dikes here, channel, and then flooding this area, as it was the previous map, sorry, to have the reconnection with the dam. In this case, the owner didn't have that much interest on this folder, but still, he's using the pond during the droughts to take the water from here and put it in the fish farm. So he had an interest. So we had to include this interest in the study so that we split the water between his needs and the biodiversity or actually free flowing, to assure the free flowing condition. So we try actually to promote the benefits. And of course, when you put some money, we have to ask some money to do something, and the agreement is that our areas, this pond and this one, which is bigger, 2,600 hectares, will be given free access to local to fish, and we can develop other activities over there. So only by playing with this interest, we can obtain something. So, common benefits, as I said, it's important to have most of the locals on board. We have to refer to fishing grounds, if this is improving, how we can handle this after the restoration, how the access will be done. In some examples, like in Balta Gerardi, the restoration had a huge impact on the vegetation of the nearby pasture, so that the local people, they saw this as a benefit and says, yes, we're willing to support this because it will improve our grazing field, and not only grazing field because of the moisture of the soil. So wild nymph, not wild crops, wild nymph appeared, so that is also really good for beekeepers that they stay there until September before entering to the winter of the bees. So, in the Danube Delta, one of the most, let's say, the principal arguments for the locals to give the lands to be flooded was to have access to natural resources, because the economy of the locals was down, so they saw only tourism opportunities and say, we have to give this land back to the to Delta so that we can develop ecotourism activities as an alternative. Other alternatives, visitor infrastructures, we built along the terrace cycling route here in Balta Gerardi, so also important for them to have something that they can promote. And reduce, as was said, for biomass or handcrafting products. And here, what I mentioned, to involve something like 1,000 almost people. It was a successful story, this project, involving all these stakeholders. Not very easy. But anyway, it was done to debates, public meetings. This is a meeting at 5 o'clock in the morning on Sunday, where people, they go to buy stuff at the market, so we have to be there to explain. So it was done several times. And here, the process of signing the agreement that they are giving their land for flooding. So just final remarks quickly, because in conservation, I think it's easy to deal with species or habitats. You know what to do mostly, but it's very difficult to work with people because they change it in the way they think. And I like this saying, which is from marketing, and people don't buy what you do. It's not about the restoration itself. It's about the reason why you do it, and they have to find a reason in that. Otherwise, they will not be supported until the end of the restoration. And because when they support the restoration, they also perceive that they can change. They can go to that change without any discomfort. And our role somehow is a leadership role. It's not about us, it's about them. And if possible, we have to find ways to improve the delegation or to delegate the management at local constituencies. Of course, we cannot stay there for a longer term, and also the authorities cannot do this jump from offices in Bucharest or whatever. Another option is to develop local businesses with conservation potential. That's all I have to say from our experience. I'll be glad to share more through email.